Hey there, and welcome back. I hope you're ready to apply your knowledge about memory potentials. Today, we will be talking about the mechanism of how neurons send a message down its axon. Like I mentioned before, this happens through electrical signaling, i.e., the movement of ions across the axon membrane. But before we get into specifics, let's take a look at an overview of neuronal signaling. Typically, when a neuron is stimulated, it initiates a signal beginning at the axon hillock. The hillock is at the base of the axon, located proximally to the cell body. Once a signal is initiated, the electrical message travels down the axon anywhere from 1 meter per second to over 100 meter per second, depending on the type of neuron, eventually reaching the synaptic terminals. Now let's take a closer look at what's happening. Here, we plugged a microelectrode to measure the axon's memory potential at this location. Let's stimulate this neuron. As the signal travels down the axon, something special happens where we placed our microelectrode. Let's take a look. In this graph, there are three distinct phases. Depolarization, meaning the memory potential increases, then hits a peak, followed by repolarization, where the memory potential returns to the resting memory potential. Lastly, we have hyperpolarization, where the potential overshoots the resting memory potential before returning back to normal. Altogether, this process is what we call the action potential. Remember, we're only recording at a single location. When we stimulate the neuron at the axon hillock, this action potential happens in a sequential manner, and it travels all the way down to the synaptic terminals. So now the question is, what is the mechanism that is responsible for these action potentials? In the last video, we explored a little bit on how ion channels that are permeable to specific ions affect the memory potential. The ions that we looked at were sodium and potassium. It turns out that the movement of these two ions are responsible for the action potential we just observed. Now let's take a closer look at what's going on at the axon membrane. Here we see three types of membrane proteins. One of them is a sodium ion channel. The other is a potassium ion channel. The last one is our sodium-potassium pump, but we'll ignore that one for now. At the resting membrane potential, the sodium and potassium channels are closed, not allowing either ion to pass through the membrane. However, something special happens when they receive an incoming electrical signal. When the axon hillock is stimulated, it triggers the influx and movement of sodium ions. In the last video, we learned that when sodium ions enter the cell, it causes the membrane to depolarize as seen on the graph at this point. Well, it turns out that the sodium and potassium ion channels are sensitive to increases in the membrane potential. When enough sodium ions cause the membrane potential to rise to around negative 55 millivolts, this triggers the opening of these ion channels. This is called the action potential threshold. If the membrane potential reaches this threshold, an action potential will fire, except under special circumstances, which we'll look into later. Because these channels are sensitive to changes in the membrane potential, we call them voltage-gated ion channels. It's important to note that the sodium ion channels are much faster to open compared to the potassium ion channels. Therefore, the open sodium channels are the ones responsible for this depolarization event we see here. Like I said a few moments ago, the sodium ion channels are opening very quickly, causing a rush of sodium ions to enter the cell, which results in a depolarization of the membrane, as you can see on the graph. At the time that we reach the peak of the action potential, around 30 millivolts, sodium channels become deactivated. On the left, you can see our sodium channel is open. Soon after, the inactivation gate represented by what looks like a ball and string that you see here, plugs up the sodium channel, not allowing any more sodium to move into the cell. At the same time, our potassium channels are now open. With our sodium channel deactivated, now we only have to focus on the potassium ion channel. Remember from our last video, we know that due to the potassium ion concentration gradient, potassium will move out of the cell. Remember, positively charged ions are leaving the inside of the cell, making the membrane potential more negative. At this point, we have repolarization, as you can see on the graph. Even after reaching the resting membrane potential, potassium channels are open for a little while longer, causing this overshoot known as hyperpolarization that you can see on the graph right here. Lastly, this overshoot is corrected slowly but surely by our good friend, the sodium-potassium pump, which returns us back to the resting membrane potential. Phew, that was a lot of things going on. Let's go ahead and review the sequence of events that happens during an action potential. First, we see that the membrane is at rest. Next, an incoming signal causes the membrane to depolarize. When the depolarization reaches the threshold value, this causes our voltage-gated ion channels to open. Because the voltage-gated sodium channels open faster, we have sodium enter the cell first, causing depolarization. At the peak, sodium ion channels are deactivated, and potassium ion channels are now open. Potassium ion rush out of the cell, causing repolarization, followed by hyperpolarization, as the membrane potential overshoots the resting membrane potential caused by the slow closing potassium ion channels. Lastly, the sodium-potassium pump slowly restores the membrane back to its resting potential. It's important to note that action potentials are what we call an all-or-nothing response, meaning that if the membrane potential hits that threshold, an action potential will fire. Now, let's go ahead and take a look at a simulation to see how this all comes together. Here, we can see an axon at a very specific location. As you can see here and here, we have our two concentrations of our ions in the extracellular and intracellular fluid. Let's go ahead and stimulate this neuron. The action potential is coming. And then we get the movement of sodium followed by the movement of potassium out of the cell. And you can see that the concentration of these ions are changing very slightly. It's important to note that this movement of sodium and potassium ions around the membrane is a very local occurrence. It doesn't really change the overall concentrations of these ions in the extracellular or intracellular fluid. So let's try this again, but this time we have our potential chart. Let's go fire this neuron. As the action potential comes into this particular spot, sodium channels are activated, allowing sodium to enter the cell, followed by potassium ion channels activating, leaving the cell, causing that hyperpolarization event to occur. Now that we've learned about the action potential, let's zoom out a little bit and see how the action potential travels down the axon. So it turns out when sodium ions enter the axonal membrane, they spread out to the surrounding areas. As sodium ions move around, it depolarizes the nearby areas as well. It turns out that if the depolarization is strong enough to reach the threshold, thereby triggering the action potential in the area downstream. This cycle propagates all the way until we reach the axon terminal. Some of you might be thinking, if sodium ions spread out and depolarizes the surrounding parts of the axon, couldn't it trigger an action potential that moves backwards towards the hillock? Well, remember this little inactivation gate I mentioned earlier? It turns out this plug is what prevents action potentials from firing backwards. If we take a look again at the action potential, the inactivation plug is partially responsible for what we call the refractory period, as indicated in the red and orange that you see here. Well, what do these colors mean? The time highlighted in red is the absolute refractory period. Here, the inactivation gate is interfering with those sodium ion channels. No matter how much we stimulate the membrane, another action potential will not occur. We also have a small period after this represented in orange. It's called the relative refractory period. Here, the action potential can occur. It's just a little bit harder. That's because it takes a bigger depolarization to reach the threshold compared to the membrane at rest. You can see the difference in the magnitude between these two arrows. With that, we're ready to learn how neurons communicate with one another. See you guys at the synapse.